nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hello, and welcome back to the nanoHUB-U course, The Physics of Electronic Polymers. Last time we talked about the molecular weight of a polymer. This time we'll talk about how polymers occupy space. And at the end of this lecture, we'd like to have two things covered. First, we want to be able to generate a general expression for the end-to-end distance of a very model polymer chain. Now, this model is very simple in nature, but it'll allow us to really build off it to build towards more realistic models in the future. The second is, once we have this general model, we want to convert it to an expression that we'll use for the freely jointed chain model in our system. So we'll be able to do both of these by the end of this lecture. And really, the first question that pops up is, if we have these big pieces of spaghetti that look like polymers, okay? So we have this real kind of black line that we have drawn through here, and this has a number of repeat units in it, right? How does this occupy space? How does it behave? How much space will a polymer with a given number of repeat units, a given number of molecular weight, occupy space? Now, this will depend a lot on the chemistry. It'll depend a lot on the molecular weight, but we need to think about how these things would look like from a very basic standpoint, and then we'll be able to pull it into how things might look like from a more realistic standpoint as we move into electronically active polymers. And one of the key ways in polymer science that we go ahead and look at this is something called the root mean square end-to-end distance. And this end-to-end distance can be thought of in the following way. If I have a polymer chain, let's just break it down. Let's not worry so much about repeat units, but let's think about the idea that I can have a polymer and it's going to start at this point right here, this little circle right here. And if we start there, we can say that we have links in this polymer chain. And each link, which I've symbolized by an L there with some kind of vector, has a length, and we'll say that all our links have the same length, but they can be pointed in different directions. And you can see here that L1 points this way, L2 points in the general same direction, L3 takes a slight turn, L4 takes a 90 degree turn, and then we keep marching along our polymer chain till we get to the final one. I'll call that L sub N. Okay, so we're going to have N number of links, and that has a final distance here. And the end-to-end distance, okay, is the distance from this final, where the vector ends, from where it stops. So that's what we're going to symbolize by the H. Okay, that's our end-to-end distance. And we can say that that end-to-end distance then must just be the summation of all I from I equals 1 to N of these Li vectors. And if you recall, the average end-to-end distance, or the root mean squared distance there, is just going to be the product of the dot products, h bar times h bar, to the 1/2 power. And if we go ahead and do that, that's just going to be the summation of links Li from I equals 1 to N dotted with the summation of links j equals 1 to N all to the 1/2 power. Okay? So that's the idea of what's going on here. If we do that, we can rewrite this in a different way, right? If this is true, then we can also say that we can just say all of the links that are the same, all the same Li's, okay? And we can take that summation, so that's Li dot Li. We can take that out. And then we can still add on Li dot Lj, where j does not equal I. So we're just breaking this down and taking out all the things that are the same versus all the things that are different. Now, if we do that, we know that Li dot Li is just L squared. And if we're going to do it n number of times, we get an n in front of it. So we get nL squared plus this cross product term of all I's that are not j's. Okay. If that's the case, we can break this down a little bit more. This is going to be our general expression that we'll use. And over the course of the next few lectures, what we'll do is we'll develop a way to think about how to think of this Li dot Lj term right here. And the first one we'll talk about is what we'll call the freely jointed chain model. And here we have a very specific, and it's very unrealistic to be quite honest, way to think about how these chains behave. And that says that these chains can move in any single direction we want. So L2 can move any which way it wants from L1. Obviously, this isn't so physically realistic because there's real chemical bonds and real polymers, but let's just stick with this model for right now, okay? Even L2 could fold all the way back and be on the exact same point as L1. That's possible in this model. Okay? And that tells us that the dot product of Li dotted with the chain before it, Li minus 1, is just L squared times the cosine of theta, where theta is the angle between, let's say, L3 and L4. This is theta right here, that angle between the two products. So here's our chain model again. And if we do this, we can think about the idea that if we dot this over all space, then if we take the average there, this is just going to be L squared, okay, times the average value of cosine theta. But I just told you that this cosine theta term, this angle can be anything. It can be all the way from 180 degrees to 0 degrees. And it can be anything. So if we do this over all space with a large number of possibilities, that cosine theta term will eventually average out to be 0. Okay? It'll have no preference about where it goes. And if that's the case, now we have L squared cosine theta, that's going to be equal to 0. So now our cross product terms for all I does not equal J are all going to be 0. Now if that's the case, we cause our general expression to be NL squared plus a term that goes away. So then we just get the NL squared back. So now we have the idea, and one of the most important concepts in all of polymer science is the idea that the root mean squared end-to-end distance of a polymer chain is proportional to the square root of the number of links, the square root of n times the length of the link L. Okay? This square root dependence will come up over and over again throughout this course. And this is kind of the basic, simplest model of how we can start to rationalize why that's the case. And this is the classic expression for what we call a random walk. Okay? Next time, what we're going to do is we're going to take this to the next level. And we're going to think about a chain that's more physically realistic. And we're not going to allow the chain to fold back onto itself. We're going to let it have some kind of certain fixed amount of rotation it can have around that bar. I hope to see you next time on the nanoHUB-U course, the physics of electronic polymers, where we'll get even more into that issue.